Are you coming to the tree with a strong...
Now that's not very Christmas me sounding music. Let's play something a little more in the spirit of the occasion.
I want a hippopotamus for Christmas. Only a hippopotamus will do. Don't want a doll, no dinky tinker toy. I want a hippopotamus to play with and enjoy. I want a hippopotamus for Christmas. I don't think Santa Claus will mind you. Him through the front door, that's the easy thing to do.
Welcome to Strange Things, broadcasting from the Raimundo Rios Mayo Library in Arcanesa. And welcome to the show. I'm Chris James, your host. This is Season 1, Episode 34. It's Saturday, December 24th. Yes, folks, it's Christmas Eve. If you haven't done your Christmas shopping already, you're running out of time. That Christmas classic was performed by Gayla Peavy. She was 10 years old when she recorded this song back in 1953. If you need a copy to round out your music collection, you can get one at iTunes for $1. Not bad for a 10-year-old. Today's show was requested by my wife Lourdes. She said, seeing as tomorrow was Christmas, we should do a Christmas-themed show. So here we are. Christmas as a strange thing. To begin with, we already know that Jesus was not really born on December 25th. Historians aren't even sure which year he was born. Some say it was the year zero, while others say it was year two. Then I've seen reference to the year negative 2. Since no one actually knows for sure when he was born, we can say December 25th is just as good as any date. We do know he was born in Bethlehem, but the exact date was written down by some clerk and filed away in the wrong drawer. And why Bethlehem? His stand-in dad had to return to his hometown of Nazareth in order to be counted in the census as decreed by Caesar Augustus. As the family was traveling from their hometown to the place where Joseph was born, the entire country was going from one town to another. The census said the family had to return to the father's hometown in order to be counted. So there they are, trying to get back home when the sun is going down. One of them said, "Hey, let's stop and get a room." So they went into Bethlehem and tried to get a room. Have you ever tried to get a room on, say, Thanksgiving without a reservation? The hotels were booked solid. So one innkeeper figured that, what the heck, you can stay in the barn. It's warm, but maybe a little smelly. The barn was actually a cave filled with animals. I've stayed in some hotels that smelled like barns, so it wasn't that bad. Dry and warm as opposed to cold and damp. Then Jesus made his appearance. Historians said that the first celebration of Christ's birth were originally grouped together with Epiphany, one of the earliest feasts of the Christian church, observed on January 6th. This holiday recognized the manifestation of Christ to the Gentiles by remembering the visit of the Magi, or the three wise men, who are sometimes called the three kings, to Bethlehem, and in some traditions the baptism of Jesus and his miracle of turning water into wine. They just lumped everything in together in one big celebration. Today, the Feast of Epiphany is observed predominantly in liturgical denominations such as Eastern Orthodox, Anglican, and Catholic. Even as far back as the 2nd and 3rd centuries, some church leaders disagreed about the appropriateness of birthday celebrations within the church. Some men, like Oregon, felt birthdays were pagan rituals for pagan gods. And since the date of Christ's actual birth had not been recorded, these early leaders speculated and argued about the date. They didn't even want members of the church to celebrate their own birthdays. Some sources report that Theophilus of Antioch, from 171 until 183, was the first to identify December 25th as the birth date of Christ. Others say it was Hippolytus, around from 170 until 236, was the first to claim that Jesus was born on December 25th. Ultimately, December 25th was chosen, perhaps as early as AD 273, but by 336 AD, the Roman Church calendar definitively recorded a nativity celebration by Western European Christians on this date. Eastern European churches maintained the January 6th commemoration together with Epiphany until sometime in the 5th or 6th century, when the 25th day of December became the widely accepted holiday. Only the Armenian Church still celebrates Christ's birth with Epiphany on January 6th. Italy's traditional celebration includes the tale of a witch known as La Befana, who arrives on her broomstick during the night of January 5th and fills the stockings with toys and sweets for the good children and a lump of coal for the bad ones. According to the legend, the night before the wise men arrived at the manger, they stopped at a shack of an old woman to ask for directions. They invited her to come along, but she replied that she was just too busy. Later, a shepherd asked her to join him, but again she refused. Later that night, she saw a great light in the sky, and decided to join the wise men and the shepherd bearing gifts that had belonged to her child who had died. She grabbed all the things she had bought for her kid and headed out into the night. From then on, she is supposed to be still traveling the world, delivering gifts to children. How she went from being an old lady to being a witch is not mentioned. Maybe it has to do with the riding a broomstick around. So now, if you'd like, you can celebrate the Christmas Witch. We're going to try to find something for everyone to enjoy. In 45 BC, Julius Caesar ordered a calendar consisting of 12 months based on a solar year. This is about the same time the zodiac lost one of its signs, Ophicius, the serpent handler. This calendar employed a cycle of 3 years, with 365 days, followed by a year with 366 days, known as the leap year. When first implemented, the Julian calendar also moved the beginning of the year from March 1st to January 1st. However, following the fall of the Roman Empire in the 5th century, the new year was gradually realigned to coincide with Christian festivals until by the 7th century, Christmas Day marked the beginning of the new year in many countries. By the 9th century, parts of southern Europe began observing the first day of the new year on March 25th, to coincide with Annunciation Day, a holiday that was 9 months prior to Christmas, celebrating the angel Gabriel's revelation to the Virgin Mary that she was about to be the mother of the Messiah. The last day of the year was March 24th. England did not adopt this change in the beginning of the new year until late in the 12th century. Because the year began in March, records referring to the first month are actually referring to March. The second month would have been April, etc. So the 19th day of the 12th month would have been February 19th. In Latin, September means 7th month, October means 8th month, November means 9th, and December is the 10th month. Use of new numbers rather than names of months was especially prevalent in Quaker records. Now, if that hasn't got you quite confused, just wait till we come back after these commercials. We will be right back after these.
I can see me now on Christmas morning creeping down the stairs. Oh, what joy and what surprise when I open up my eyes to see a hippo hero standing there.
You're listening to Arcanasa Radio. Do you have skin? Would you like to take better care of it? Call Lourdes James, independent beauty consultant, and set up an appointment. Call 723-3019. If your vision isn't what it used to be, and you're not sure you're seeing Bigfoot or just your neighbor mowing his lawn, stop on by Del Norte Optical, 107 Calle del Norte, just across the street from the Embassy Suites. You should be able to see what you're looking at. Looking for a great cup of coffee? Swing on by the Organic Man Coffee Trike, 1002 Iturbe Day, Suite Number 7. Not a coffee drinker? They have hot chocolate, hot tea, and sometimes muffins and cookies. It's a great place to meet your friends for a conversation or curl up in the corner with a good book. The Organic Man Coffee Trike. Life is too short to drink bad coffee.
Though we gotta say goodbye.
No, don't say goodbye. Stay with us. This is Arcanasa Radio. Quédate con nosotros, estás escuchando Arcanasa Radio.
You're listening to Strange Things with Chris James.
I want a hippopotamus for Christmas. Only a hippopotamus will do. No crocodiles, no rhinoceroses. I only like hippopotamuses, and hippopotamuses like me too.
Welcome back, and so far, if we haven't confused you yet, it may get a little more so. During the Middle Ages, it became apparent that the Julian leap year formula had overcompensated for the actual length of the solar year, having added an extra day every 128 years. However, no adjustments were made to compensate. By 1582, seasonal equinoxes were falling 10 days too soon, and some of the church holidays, such as Easter, did not fall in the proper season. In that year, Pope Gregory XIII authorized, and most Roman Catholic countries adopted, the Gregorian, or New Style, calendar as part of the change. 10 days were dropped from the month of October, and the formula for determining leap year was revised so that only years divisible by 400, such as 1600 or 2000, at the end of the century would be leap years. January 1st was established as the first day of the new year. Protestant countries, including England and its colonies, not recognizing the authority of the Pope, continued to use the Julian calendar. So, for a while, the date was determined by which religion you were following. So, figuring out when Jesus was born, 2016 years or so ago, it just isn't going to happen. Then there's the problem with his name. Jesus is not a Jewish name. You can't find anybody in Jerusalem named Jesus today, unless he's on vacation from a Latin American country. Jewish people say that Jesus' real name was Yeshua. Indeed, Yeshua is the Hebrew name for Jesus. It means the Lord is salvation. The English spelling of Yeshua is Joshua. However, when translated from Hebrew into Greek language, in which the New Testament was written, the name Yeshua becomes Issuus. The English spelling for Issuus is Jesus. What this means is Joshua and Jesus are the same name. One is translated from Hebrew to English and the other from Greek into English. It's interesting to note the name Joshua and Isaiah are essentially the same names as Yeshua in Hebrew. They mean a Savior and the salvation of the Lord. His mother wasn't named Mary either. Her name was Martha. Mary isn't a Jewish name. Once more, it's that whole Greek to English translation problem. Okay, now I'll bet you're really confused. Don't get all caught up in the details. It's far more important that you remember who Jesus was and what he said than the absolute correct pronunciation of his name or the date of his birth. When someone says Jesus, you automatically think of the Son of God. When someone says Joshua, I think of a guy I used to work with. So, if it makes you feel better, just think December 25th is the date that we celebrate the birth of a man we know as Jesus. The important thing is to remember he was here and he had some important things for us to remember. The tradition of using evergreen boughs, including holly and mistletoe, as decoration during winter celebrations is ancient. In the Middle East, trees were traditionally cut down, brought into the home, and decorated. Evergreens are a natural symbol of hope and promise of renewed life in the spring. When most plants are barren in Europe, the evergreen is still well green. Today, the Christmas tree is the most famous and widely used legacy of this tradition that predates Christianity. In the early days of the Christian church, and even up until the 19th century, the use of evergreen decorations and trees during Christmas was discouraged and sometimes prohibited because of its pagan associations. Although many other elements of the pre-Christian winter holiday, such as the Roman Saturnalia, were retained in Christmas celebrations, evergreen decorations were commonly condemned. Ironically, some people today object to the public display of Christmas trees, saying it's a Christian symbol, even though it's only been Christian for a few decades. Those who object should go back and read a bit of history. The first incarnation of the Christmas tree as we know it occurred in the 16th century in Germany, where it was used to celebrate a 24th of December holiday called the Feast of Adam and Eve. They called them paradise trees, and they were supposed to represent the tree of knowledge discussed in the book of Genesis. German immigrants brought the tree to America in the 17th century, and it became accepted as a Christmas decoration throughout the Western world sometime around 1850. President Franklin Pierce is credited with bringing the first one into the White House around this time. And President Calvin Coolidge founded the National Christmas Tree Lighting Ceremony, which took place on the White House lawn in 1923. The tree was traditionally decorated with edibles, such as apples, nuts, and other kinds of food. In the 18th century, it began to be illuminated by candles, which were ultimately replaced by Christmas lights once electricity was available. Today, there's a wide variety of traditional ornaments, such as garlands, baubles, tinsel, and candy canes. An angel or star might be placed on the top of the tree to represent the Archangel Gabriel or the Star of Bethlehem from the Nativity. Edible items such as gingerbread, chocolate, and other sweets are also popular and are tied to
tied to or hung from the tree's branches with ribbons. At our house, we find a new ornament each year that represents some major achievement from the year. One decoration is a book, representing the first book I published. There's a little microphone for this year, since the show Strange Things was kicked off this year. My most prized ornament is a flying saucer signed by Travis Walton when he visited Laredo. In India, only about 2.3% of the population are Christians. Seeing as India has such a large population, we're talking about 25 million people. Christians in India celebrate Christmas with midnight mass and gift-giving like the rest of the world, but with the absence of fir trees or pine trees to decorate, they usually made do with banana trees and mango trees instead. This means instead of Christmas pine, you'll find brightly lit, well-decorated Christmas bananas or mango trees on the streets. They even use the leaves of these trees to decorate their homes. Now try to picture your family gathered around the banana tree handing out gifts. It is nice to see there are others who celebrate Christmas all around the planet, though. If a person is so set on complaining that the Christmas tree is based on a pagan celebration, just remind them, there's not much today that can't be traced back to pagan ideas because they've been around a lot longer than Christians. If you don't want to celebrate another Christmas single, try this. Stand with your back to the door and throw a shoe over your shoulder on Christmas Day. If the shoe lands with the toe pointed to the door, congratulations, you're going to get married. There's no clue as to how long before you might meet your Prince Charming, but he's on his way, someday. And just like how Christmas turkey is the must on Christmas, in Japan, the dinner of choice is Colonel Sanders' Kentucky Fried Chicken. Since the beginning of this marketing campaign 4 decades ago, KFC has been associated with Christmas in the minds of Japanese for generations, a tradition passed on from parent to child in spite of its commercialized beginnings. More than 240,000 barrels of chicken will be sold during Christmas, 5 to 10 times its normal monthly sale. In Japan, it just isn't Christmas without KFC. Another Christmas food associated with Japan is Christmas cake. These sponge cakes with whipped cream, chocolate, and strawberries on top are ordered months in advance and are eaten on Christmas Eve. Any cake that is not sold after the 25th is considered to be unwanted. A single women in Japan over the age of 25 used to be called Christmas cakes. Families in Finland usually visit the graves of their ancestors and relatives on Christmas Eve to light candles in memory of the deceased. Even those who don't have family members' graves nearby visit the cemeteries to place candles in honor of their family members buried elsewhere. Hence, on Christmas Eve, the cemeteries would be lit up with candles, looking kind of like some folks' houses around here. Most Finnish families have their own sauna. It's believed that a sauna elf lives in the sauna. The elf is there to make sure people behave themselves. And every Christmas Eve, people would head to their sauna, strip to their birthday suits, and enjoy a nice good sweat. After sunset, the place is for the spirits of the dead ancestors, so everybody must leave. The food will also be left on tables, and family members wind up sleeping on the floor. This is done in order to give the dead a nice meal and a place to sleep when they visit. This sounds a little bit like their Day of the Dead. In the capital city of Caracas, before young children go to bed on Christmas Eve, They tie one end of a string to their big toe and hang the other end out their bedroom window. The fun part of Christmas celebration is on the day of early morning mass, the streets are closed off to all cars. People roller skate along the streets on their way to church. As they go, they pull on any of the strings they see hanging from the windows as a way to tell these people that are still asleep, it's time for church. 1966, a 13-meter-tall goat figure made of straw was erected in the town square of Gavel, Sweden. At the stroke of midnight, Christmas Eve, the goat went up in flames. The town never stopped building it year after year. The vandals never stopped trying to burn the goat down. The goat has already been burnt down 25 times by the vandals. The burning of the Gavel goat happened so often that bookmakers began taking bets on the survival of the goat in 1988. Instead of glittering ornaments and tinsel, Ukrainian Christmas trees are covered with artificial spiders and spider webs. According to local folklore, there was a poor woman who could not afford to decorate her Christmas tree. But the next morning, her children woke to see the tree covered with webs. And when the first light of Christmas morning touched the webs, they turned into gold and silver, and the family had money from then on. Hence, it is believed that seeing a spider web on Christmas morning will bring you luck. We're going to take a break here for a few commercials. Don't go away. We'll be right back after these important messages.
Mom says a hippo would eat me up, but then teacher says a hippo is a vegetarian. And wash him there and give him his massage. I can see me now on Christmas morning creeping down the stairs. Oh, what joy and what surprise when I open up my eyes to see a hippo hero standing there.
You're listening to Arcanasa Radio. Do you have skin? Would you like to take better care of it? Call Lourdes James, independent beauty consultant, and set up an appointment. Call 723-3019. If your vision isn't what it used to be, and you're not sure you're seeing Bigfoot or just your neighbor mowing his lawn, stop on by Del Norte Optical. 107 Calle del Norte, just across the street from the Embassy Suites. You should be able to see what you're looking at. Looking for a great cup of coffee? Swing on by the Organic Man Coffee Truck. 1002 Iturbide Day, Suite Number 7. Not a coffee drinker? They have hot chocolate, hot tea, and sometimes muffins and cookies. It's a great place to meet your friends for a conversation or curl up in the corner with a good book. The Organic Man Coffee Truck. Life is too short to drink bad coffee.
Though we gotta say goodbye. No, don't say goodbye. Stay with us. This is Arcanasa Radio. Quédate con nosotros, estás escuchando Arcanasa Radio.
Your You're listening to Strange Things with Chris James.
I want a hippopotamus for Christmas. Only a hippopotamus will do. No crocodiles or rhinoceroses. I only like hippopotamuses. And hippopotamuses like me too.
Hard to believe she was only 10 years old when she recorded that. Welcome back to the show. Hopefully you're not too confused by this time by all the changes and redirections that went on through the years. Now how about the chubby guy dressed in red and white who sneaks into your home late at night and leaves gifts under the tree? The legend of Santa Claus can be traced back hundreds of years to a monk named Saint Nicholas. It is believed that Nicholas was born sometime around 280 A.D. in Patara near Myra in modern-day Turkey. Much admired for his piety and kindness, Saint Nicholas became the subject of many legends. It is said that he gave away all of his inherited wealth and traveled the countryside helping the poor and sick. One of the best known of St. Nicholas' stories is that he saved three poor sisters from being sold into slavery or prostitution by their father, by providing them with a dowry so they could get married. Every time I read this bit, I wonder why their father was such a dick. I mean, really, sell your own kids? He should be drugged naked down a gravel road. Over the course of many years, Nicholas' popularity spread, and he became known as the protector of children and sailors. His feast day is celebrated on the anniversary of his death, December 6th. This was traditionally considered a lucky day to make large purchases or to get married. By the Renaissance, Saint Nicholas was the most popular saint in Europe. For several hundred years, circa 1200 to 1500, St. Nicholas was the unchallenged bringer of gifts and the center of celebrations on or near December 6th. The strict saint took on some aspects of earlier European deities, like the Roman Saturn or the Norse Odin, who appeared as a white-bearded man and they had magical powers. He also ensured that kids toed the line by saying their prayers and practicing good manners. Even after the Protestant Reformation, when the veneration of saints began to be discouraged, Saint Nicholas maintained a positive reputation, especially in Holland. So who's going to be credited with bringing all those gifts if not Saint Nick? In many cases, the job fell to the baby Jesus. And the date was moved from December 6th to December 25th, or Christmas. But an infant carrying capacity is somewhat limited, and he's not very scary. It sounds wrong to say you'd better behave or Jesus will whip your butt. So Christ was often given a scary helper to do the lugging of presents and the threatening of kids that didn't seem appropriate to be coming from Jesus. Some of these scary Germanic figures were based on Nicholas, no longer as a saint, but as a threatening sidekick like Ruklaus, which means rough Nicholas, Aschenklaus, which means ashy Nicholas since he comes down the chimney, and Pelznickel, or furry Nicholas. These figures expected good behavior, or they forced children to suffer the consequences like whippings or kidnappings. Dissimilar as they seem to the jolly man in red, these colorful characters would later figure in the development of Santa himself. And this is also where the legend of Krampus comes from. If you thought being on Santa's naughty list was the scariest thing to happen around Christmas, you've never heard of Krampus Night. Krampus is Santa's evil twin, whose job is to beat and punish all children who have misbehaved. On December 5th, men dressed in some of the scary devil-like costumes you can imagine and would drunkenly run around town hitting people with sticks and switches. The Krampus legend originates in the Germanic Alpine region and is widespread throughout Hungary, Bavaria, Slovenia, and especially popular in Austria. In the Netherlands, kids and families simply refused to give up St. Nicholas as a gift bringer. They brought Sinterklaas with them to the New World colonies, where the legends of the shaggy and scary Germanic gift bringers also endured. In early America, Christmas wasn't much like the modern holiday. It was shunned in New England, and everywhere it became a bit like a pagan Saturnalia that once occupied its place on the calendar. It was celebrated as a kind of outdoor, alcohol-fueled, rowdy community blowout. Christmas spirit was more like Christmas spirits. 18th century America's Santa Claus was not the only St. Nicholas-inspired gift giver to make an appearance on a Christmas night. The similar figures were popular all over the world. Christkind, or Kris Kringle, was believed to deliver presents to well-behaved Swiss and German children. Meaning Christ child, Christkind is an angel-like figure often accompanied by St. Nicholas on his holiday missions. In Scandinavia, a jolly elf named Jutmunden was thought to deliver gifts in a sleigh drawn by goats. English legend explains that Father Christmas visits each night on Christmas Eve to fill children's stockings with holiday treats. Père Noël is responsible for filling the shoes of French children. In Russia, it's believed that an elderly woman named Babushka gave the three wise men wrong directions to Bethlehem so that they would wind up getting lost. Later, she felt remorseful, but could not find the men to undo the damage. To this day, on January 5th, Babushka visits Russian children, leaving gifts at their bedside in the hope that one of them will turn out to be Jesus, and that way he may forgive her. The name Santa Claus evolved from Nicholas' Dutch nickname Sinterklaas, a shortened form of Sint Nicholas. In 1804, John Pintard, a member of the New York Historical Society, distributed woodcuts of St. Nicholas at the Society's annual meeting. The background of the engraving contained now familiar Santa images, including stockings filled with toys and fruit hanging over the fireplace. 1809, Washington Irving helped to popularize the Sinterklaas stories when he referred to St. Nicholas as the patron saint of New York in his book, The History of New York. As his prominence grew, Sinterklaas was described as everything from a rascal with a blue three-cornered hat to a red vest and yellow stockings to a man wearing a broad-brimmed hat and a huge pair of Flemish trunk hose. Now, a Flemish trunk hose are not trunks, nor are they hoses. They are those saggy boots you see pirates wearing, the kind that look like they're sliding down from their knees. Then, during the early decades of the 19th century, all that changed thanks to a series of poets and writers who strove to make Christmas a family celebration by reviving and remaking St. Nicholas. Washington Irving's 1809 Knickerbocker's History of New York first portrayed a pipe-smoking Nicholas soaring over the rooftops in a flying wagon, delivering presents to good girls and boys, and beating the bad ones. And by 1821, an anonymous illustrated poem entitled The Children's Friend went much farther in shaping the modern Santa and associating him with Christmas. Here we finally have the appearance of a Santa Claus. They've taken the magical gift-bringing of St. Nicholas, stripped him of any religious characteristics, and dressed this saint, or Santa, in furs of those shaggy Germanic gift-bringers. That figure brought gifts to good girls and boys, but he also sported a birch rod that a parent should use when their kids are on the naughty list. The Santa's wagon was pulled by a single reindeer, but both driver and team would get a major renovation the following year. 1822, Clement Clark Moore, an Episcopal minister, wrote a long Christmas poem for his three daughters entitled An Account of a Visit from St. Nicholas. Moore's poem, which he was initially hesitant to publish due to the frivolous nature of its subject, is largely responsible for a modern image of Santa Claus as a right jolly old elf with a portly figure and supernatural abilities to ascend a chimney with a mere nod of his head. Although some of Moore's imagery was probably borrowed from other sources, his poem helped popularize the now familiar image of Santa Claus, who flew from house to house on Christmas Eve in a miniature sleigh, led by eight flying reindeer, leaving presents for deserving children. An account of a visit from St. Nicholas created a new and immediately popular American icon. Stores began to advertise Christmas shopping in 1820. By 1840s, newspapers were creating separate sections for holiday advertisements, which often featured images of the newly popular Santa Claus. In 1841, thousands of children visited the Philadelphia shop to see a life-size Santa Claus model. It was only a matter of time before stores began to attract children and their parents with the lure of a peek at a live Santa Claus. In early 1890, the Salvation Army needed money to pay for the free Christmas meal they provided to needy families. They began dressing up unemployed men in Santa Claus suits and sending them out into the streets of New York to solicit donations. Those familiar Salvation Army Santas have been ringing bells on street corners of American cities ever since. Once firmly established, North America's Santa then underwent a kind of a reverse migration to Europe, replacing the scary gift-bringers and adopting local names like Père Noël in France or Father Christmas in Great Britain. In Russia, Santa Claus fell afoul of Joseph Stalin. Before the Russian Revolution, Grandfather Frost was a favored figure of Christmas who had adopted characteristics of both Santa and Sinterklaas. When the Soviet Union was formed, the communists abolished the celebration of Christmas. In 1930, when Stalin needed to beef up his support, he allowed the reemergence of Grandfather Frost, not as a Christmas gift-bringer, but as a New Year's gift-bringer. Attempts to displace Christmas in Russia were ultimately unsuccessful, as were Soviet attempts to spread a secular version of Grandfather Frost, complete with a blue coat, to avoid being associated with the red-costumed Santa from across Europe. If you're one of those folks who just plain hate Santa Claus for whatever reason, okay, be that way. Live in a world devoid of magic. I just don't need to hear about it. Be a Grinch, but keep it to yourself. Rudolph, the most famous reindeer of all, was born over 100 years after his eight flying counterparts. The Red-Nosed Wonder was a creation of Robert L. May, a copywriter at Montgomery Ward's department stores. Are there even any Ward's department stores left out there? 1939, May wrote a Christmas-themed story poem to help bring traffic into his store. using a similar rhyme pattern to Moore's 'Twas the Night Before Christmas, May told the story of Rudolph, a young reindeer who was teased by the other deer because of his large, glowing red nose. But then Christmas Eve turns foggy, and Santa, worried that he wouldn't be able to deliver gifts that night, the former outcast saved Christmas by leading the sleigh by the light of his red nose. Rudolph's message that, given the opportunity, a liability can be turned into an asset, proved very popular. Montgomery Ward's sold almost 2.5 million copies of the story in 1939. When it was reissued in 1946, the book sold over 3.5 million copies. Several years later, one of May's friends, Johnny Mark, wrote a short song based on the Rudolph story. It was recorded by Gene Autry, and it sold over 2 million copies. Since then, the story has been translated into 25 languages and was made into a television movie narrated by Burl Ives, which has charmed audiences every year since 1964. Now, Christmas is huge in the Philippines. Since 80% of the population are Christians, the celebrations last all the way into January. The children will leave their brightly polished shoes and freshly washed socks on the windowsill for the three kings to leave gifts in when they pass through their houses at night. The Feast of the Three Kings marks the end of Christmas celebrations. Now, Christmas pudding is served on Christmas Day, but the tradition has to do with how it's made. Every member of the family is to stir the mix clockwise while making a wish. Early traditions included putting a coin in the mix, which is supposed to bring wealth to whoever finds it in their serving. Other additions include a ring for good luck in marriage and a thimble for good luck in life. We're going to take a brief pause here and play a few commercials. Don't go anywhere. We'll be right back.
I want a hippopotamus for Christmas. Only a hippopotamus will do. Don't want a doll, no dinky tinker toy. I want a hippopotamus to play with and enjoy. I want a hippopotamus for Christmas. I don't.
You're listening to Arcanasa Radio. Do you have skin? Would you like to take better care of it? Call Lourdes James, independent beauty consultant, and set up an appointment. Call 723-3019. If your vision isn't what it used to be, and you're not sure you're seeing Bigfoot or just your neighbor mowing his lawn, stop on by Del Norte Optical, 107 Calle del Norte, just across the street from the Embassy Suites. You should be able to see what you're looking at. Looking for a great cup of coffee? Swing on by the Organic Man Coffee Truck, 1002 Eaterby Day, Suite Number 7. Not a coffee drinker? They have hot chocolate, hot tea, and sometimes muffins and cookies. It's a great place to meet your friends for a conversation or curl up in the corner with a good book. The Organic Man Coffee Trike. Life is too short to drink bad coffee.
Though we gotta say goodbye. No, don't say goodbye. Stay with us. This is Arcanasa Radio. Quédate con nosotros, estás escuchando Arcanasa Radio.
Every day in a letter, sealed with a kiss.
You're listening to Strange Things with Chris James.
Santa Claus will mind you. He won't have to use a dirty chimney flue. Just bring him through the front door. That's the easy thing to do. I can see me now on Christmas morning creeping down the stairs.
And welcome back to the show. Now, where are you going to send your letters to Santa? The North Pole? Santa's workshop? Actually, Santa has his own postal code. H0H0H0. It's in Canada, where postal codes are alphanumeric. Letters used to end up undeliverable because there was no centralized address for Kris Kringle. But now you know where to send them. H0H0H0. For the last 30 years, Canada Postal volunteers have been helping Santa reply to millions of letters from children around the world and in different languages, including Braille. George Washington crossed the Delaware River during the evening of December 25th, 1776. Every schoolboy and schoolgirl around probably knows why he made his famous Revolutionary War crossing when he did. Washington wanted to catch the Hessian mercenaries employed by the British military by surprise in the midst of their holiday celebrations. And he did. The general crushed the enemy and captured plenty of arms and prisoners at the same time. Washington and his men won an outstanding Christmas victory, which went down in American history books. One of the most amazing and bizarre things to happen on Christmas Day came amongst the blood and carnage of trench warfare in World War I. For several days during the holiday celebrations, a temporary but unofficial ceasefire had broke out between the British and the German forces serving along the Western Front. Private Frank Sumter was sitting in a British trench, feeling cold and lonely, when he heard singing coming from the German line. The Germans were singing Silent Night. Private Leslie Wilkinson said that some of the lads would stick their heads up over the top and wave and then drop back down real quick. Normally, this would have been a quick way to get shot by a German sniper. No one was shot. Instead, they soon saw the Germans were standing up and waving back. Some brave soul was the first to step out into no man's land and begin walking towards the enemy line. Soon, both sides were spilling out into the destruction between the two armies and embracing those they had been trying to kill just day before. Neither side had considered the fact that the enemy was just as miserable and cold and lonely as them. Consorting with the enemy was just one step away from treason. You could get shot for this kind of behavior. But this was Christmas, and both sides were away from their families and feeling the need for something to celebrate. Some of the soldiers ventured across the enemy lines and brought Christmas gifts with them. Groups of soldiers even sang carols with their enemies and played a few games of soccer. War can be brutal and strange, yet somehow peppered with acts of kindness. The soldiers don't really hate each other like politicians do. The soldiers tend to respect and care for each other far beyond anything civilians will ever understand. They share the terror, the heartache, the cold, the mud, the danger. This tends to draw the combatants together. One German soldier, caught up in the Christmas spirit, gave his dress helmet to one of the British soldiers. A week later, he was told he needed to participate in a parade in full-dress uniform. His pickle hob was on the other side of no man's land. He wondered how he'd go about getting it back. Late that night, the German soldier snuck out into the center of the two armies, and he made contact with the British sentry on duty. He asked to speak with the soldier in possession of his dress helmet. The British soldier crawled out to meet with his enemy, and he returned the prized gift. Once the parade had been dealt with, the German soldier once more snuck out into the wasteland, and he returned the helmet to its new owner. I know this sounds a bit too fantastic, but in times of great strife and turmoil, people have been known to do some amazing things. When the high command on both sides got wind of this unofficial truce, they passed rules stating this kind of thing was to be dealt with in a very stern manner if it ever happened again. As stern as in firing squads. Norwegian legend says that on Christmas Eve, witches and evil spirits come out looking for brooms to ride on. To thwart these witches, all brooms in the house are hidden, and men go outside and fire shotguns to scare the bad spirits away. Jolak O'Turin is a Yuletide cat, or the Christmas cat. He's not a nice cat. He might eat you. See, in many Icelandic families, those who finish all their work on time receive new clothes for Christmas. Those who are lazy did not. To encourage children to work hard, their parents told of the Yuletide cat, saying that Jolak O'Turin could tell who the lazy children were because they didn't have at least one new item of clothing for Christmas, and they would be sacrificed to the Yule cat. A poem written about the cat ends with a suggestion that children help out the needy so they too can have a protection of new clothing. It's no wonder that Icelandic people put in more overtime than just about anybody else in Europe. Jólasveinar, or Yule lads, are Icelandic trolls. In ancient times, they stole things and caused trouble around Christmas time, so they were used to scare children into behavior, kind of like the Yuletime cat. However, in the 20th century, culture creep brought the tales of the malevolent Norwegian figure called Julen Ice, Santa Claus, who brought gifts to good children. He was the carrot while the Yule lads were the stick. The tradition became to mingle until the formerly devilish trolls became kind of gift givers. They would show up in the middle of the night and leave presents in your shoes, if you're a good boy and girl. This gift-giving used to last for 13 days straight. That's because there are 13 Yule lads, and they each have their own name and a distinctive personality. I am not even going to attempt their names. Icelandic is one of the hardest languages on the planet to learn. A custom doesn't have to be all that old to be traditional. In Sweden, every Christmas Eve, families gather around the TV at 3 p.m. to watch Kjell Anka och Han Vanner Oscar Gott Jul. In English, that's Donald Duck and his friends wish you a Merry Christmas. We know it as a 1958 Disney presentation, From All of Us to All of You. A collection of cartoons that, for the most part, have nothing to do with Christmas. The most popular is the one in which the Erikun bird bedevils Donald Duck. Many Swedes can recite the dubbed-in lines by heart. The tradition began in 1959 when Sweden had only a couple of TV channels and there weren't all that many homes with TV sets. People would gather together to watch Disney special, and it became a shared experience. Since then, any time the public TV channel considered not airing Kjell Anka, viewers rallied to have it restored to the schedule. They really loved their Donald Duck. The tradition of mummers is associated with the winter solstice more than Christmas. It dates back to pagan times when people would try to employ magic to encourage the sun to return before daylight completely disappeared. In Britain, mummers perform small dramas about the struggle between the sun and the forces of winter. a tradition that survives to this day in some areas. In Latvia, Christmas time is still a solstice holiday and is often celebrated from December 22nd through the 25th. Customs of a Latvian Christmas are usually traced to activities that encourage the return of the Sun Maiden. Latvian mummers are more like Halloween trick-or-treaters, going from house to house wearing masks, usually disguised as some form of animal or a spirit of the dead. They play music and bestow blessings on the homes they visit, and are given food to eat. Looking to mix up your Christmas food this year? How about embracing the Polish tradition of serving carp instead of turkey? In Poland, it's traditional to serve up this particular fish on Christmas Eve, which is when the main Christmas celebration is held, instead of the 25th. The carp is, however, just one of 12 individual courses that grace the average Polish Christmas dinner table. Why 12? One for each of the apostles. It seems Jesus doesn't get his own dish. If you're feeling particularly superstitious, it is said that by taking one of the carp scales and placing it in your wallet, it will bring you good fortune for the year ahead. So now you're thoroughly confused about what we're about to celebrate. Here's what you need to do. Be good all year long, just like Jesus told you to be. After all, he is the reason for the season. Get together with your friends and family and have a good time. Give gifts that mean something and not just because, and be happy for what you have. Lastly, try to remember what Dave Ramsey says. Act your wage. Merry Christmas to everyone out there.
Oh, what joy and what surprise when I open up my eyes to see a hippo hero standing there. I want a hippopotamus for Christmas. Only a hippopotamus will do. No crocodiles, no rhinoceroses. I only like hippopotamuses, and hippopotamuses like me too. Says a hippo is a vegetarian. There's lots of room for him in our two-car garage. I'd feed him there and wash him there and give him his massage. I can see me now on Christmas morning creeping down the stairs. Oh, what joy and what surprise when I open up my eyes to see a hippo hero standing there. I want a hippopotamus for Christmas. Only a hippopotamus will do. No crocodiles or rhinoceroses. I only like hippopotamuses, and hippopotamuses like me too.